Hi, everyone. I'm Michael Whistler, and I sincerely believe that science fiction can help us save the world. On this episode, I am joined by a couple of friends of mine, and we are going to get to discuss how to save the world from aliens that shoot spikes out of their butts. I mean, their tails or something like that. Anyway, and it will be completely contradiction-free time travel, right? Or I think maybe something like that. Maybe not. I don't know.
Yep.
Well, let's find out. This is Exploring Tomorrow. So on this episode, I'm going to be joined by Chris Wong, who's been on the show before. Encourage you to go back and check out this couple episodes, actually, where we've discussed a few things. Always a pleasure to have you on, Chris. Thanks for coming back.
Michael, who used to study philosophy in college and now does filmmaking and is an author, thank you so much for having me. It's great to be back.
I got you doing an intro for me all of a sudden. It's true. It's true.
Well, that's what he did. But that's what he did in the movie. Every time he introduced a new person, he would like give their entire backstory.
Right. That's true. Always have that context, right?
Yep.
And joining us this time is Wong Naa Dodoo, who teaches marketing communication, which I've been trying to figure out a way to sneak into one of her classes at some point. We all know each other because we meet on Zoom almost weekly, really, and discuss movies. And so this time we decided to kind of cross worlds a little bit. Not everybody from the movie discussion group is here, but we wanted to geek out and watch a new science fiction movie, the Amazon original movie, The Tomorrow War, which if you happen to be watching the video feed of this, we all decided, really inspired by Chris's choice, to feature backgrounds that are relevant to this movie. So this should be a fun, informal, fascinating discussion about what works and what doesn't about this particular time travel alien attack movie. And so I think we can start off by opening up the floor for overall rating. We do this in our group often, and I think it's it lends itself well to really good discussion right off the bat. You know, 1 to 10, what did we think? Now, would you like to go first?
Sure. I will give it a solid 7.
Nice. Solid 7. Mm-hmm. Excellent. How about you, Chris?
I would agree with that 7. It was better than I thought it was going to be. I was worried that it was just going to be straight action shoot 'em up. But then they went back to the science. I mean, and they really went back into like chemistry, like deep chemistry and biology. So that was great. But yeah.
All right, so we got a couple 7s. I would say I'm probably somewhere in the vicinity of a 5.5 to 6, somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. So five for me is like the fulcrum of apathy, shall we call it? It's like it's where a movie just kind of teeters. And it could go either way. Like, I just don't have strong feelings about it one way or another. I find it forgettable, you know. But, here's the thing about this one. Like, it's that this one definitely doesn't quite get close to the fulcrum quite. Like, it doesn't sit on the fulcrum because I don't think it's necessarily completely forgettable. I was thoroughly entertained every moment of the movie. You know, like it's definitely entertaining, no doubt about it. At the same time, as a fan of science fiction, there's a lot of I know it's you know, I think a lot of people in reviews online have pointed it out as well. So it's very tropey. It's a lot of science fiction tropes presented in this movie. And it's and there is a degree of like, does it necessarily do anything really new with those tropes, or does it just really rely on those tropes as a way to make a very entertaining seeming update to Starship Troopers in a lot of ways, because it shares thematically certainly a lot of crossover to a degree with Starship Troopers, where you've got the crazy bug aliens as well. And these aren't quite bugs, they're more monster like, but they're completely non-humanoid and they're hell-bent on violence. And so, you know, it's us or them kind of situation. The difference here being no one has to get on a ship and go to the aliens planet. We replace that with you've got to get a weird, you know, sleeve on your arm and travel into the future. Mm-hmm.
But Michael, I guess the question, my question from your analysis right there is, does every science fiction entry have to do something new?
No, this is fair. I don't think it necessarily has to do something, I think, specifically new. I think the difference is, does it feel fresh in its approach and its take? Does it do something? I think the newness is not always necessarily going to be, did you figure out a new way to, do big science fiction concepts? Sometimes, occasionally, you're gonna do that, and you'll come across that, and it's really remarkable. I think the difference there is, does a science fiction story present the characters and the scenario and the struggles they go through in some fashion that breathes a new perspective or something, some sort of new life into it? And to be fair, and I think one reason why I think I can still overall give everyone involved with this movie a high five, so to speak, is that I understand also the context that, by and large, this is clearly, it is essentially meant to be an action movie. It doesn't, you know, you and I had discussed prior to seeing the movie, when we saw the trailer, are they going to do the classic thing of the sci-fi element is purely a setup, and we literally just kind of forget about it after that? Like, hey, within the first act, you know, hey, time travel and aliens, and then the rest of the time it's just brrr. But there was a little more to it than that, which was satisfying. But yeah, I think, you know, but the overall context is still, it's a blockbuster sci-fi movie where you're shooting aliens. It's not even Inception, which in itself is still an action movie, but it's an action movie that you got to stay wide awake for. You know, yeah. You got to be paying attention.
Yep.
But tell me a little more about the Sevens. What did you like? What did you not like?
Now, why don't you go first? What did you like about it?
I'm like giving you time.
He's like, yeah, let me gather my thoughts.
What did I like about it? I like the side character. The guy who's working for the tech company. What's his name?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
He was like the comedic.
Yeah. The head of research. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. He was. I liked him. Yeah.
Yeah. Overall, I felt like, you know, they were able to tell a fairly, you know, cohesive story. There's this guy who used to be in the Marines. He's trying to get back into something, but in the meantime, he's teaching high school students, and then he's watching a soccer match, and then this thing happens where everybody needs to be drafted, and then that's his experience, and then he comes back and tries to save his daughter. Like, in a nutshell, that's basically it, right? And then he has to shoot people. aliens
yeah.
take the lead because he's done it before. But yeah, I mean so overall I was like, oh okay, I mean it's straightforward. Mm-hmm. And what I didn't like were the little I felt like there could have been more substance to some of the characters, like even like the expositions by some of the characters. Oh, there's this guy, he's been there. Yeah. He shot the first ever. And he has like a souvenir or whatnot. And then yeah. there was like very little to no backstory for some of the
yeah.
like featured characters. Mm-hmm. Civilians who can suddenly shoot, even though, you know, they were like, they weren't there for the entire week they were supposed to be training, and they suddenly got pulled into this thing. Yeah. And then you leave, I'll save us. And then, you know, anyway, so just little things like that. But overall, yeah, it's a good action movie. I like Chris Pratt.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, I think Chris Pratt, I think he's a good, he's a charismatic actor. You know, I put him in the same kind of league as Tom Cruise. Like, he's good at what he does. Like, he's effective at this kind of role. Like, once he found his role, he's effective at it. He's likable. He's good at playing like an everyday person, sort of.
Yeah, kind of the everyman. He's like a slightly funnier Matt Damon in that way. Kind of got that everyman kind of thing. Like, yeah.
I felt like he deviated a little bit from his role in like Guardians of the Galaxy. He was more serious in this one. He wasn't, as, you know, clueless or, you know, as
right.
you know, happy-go-lucky.
Right, person. Right. But, yeah.
Yeah.
I would say this movie is actually three separate movies, right? Like the first part is like the alien invasion, like fighting aliens. The second part is like zoology and biology, and like let's really get into genetics and immunology here. And the third one is like let's explore history and science and have a snow adventure.
Yeah. I think at this point it's probably safe to say we haven't given too much away, but if you're listening to this and you're like, wait, I kind of do want to check this out, probably going forward.
You
know,
a little bit.
Just a little. That's fine. That's, you know, I don't think honestly we've given much away at all that mm-hmm. That you can't figure out. I mean, certainly the movie definitely does play off of that, like some similar theme that you see in different movie that we watched for our group, right? In the Shadow of the Moon. There's a time travel father and daughter dynamic going on there as well, that kind of plays into it. Certainly not the first to play with that sort of familial context, but it does. They do it in a very, I think, a fun and interesting way, but it's not overly surprising. You figure that you come across that fairly early on in the movie still, I think, in the grand scheme of things, once you figure that out.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think one of the things that drove me the craziest about this movie is at the beginning, well, one, they're having this Christmas party and they're all watching the World Cup.
Yeah. That one didn't, like, I was like, why is the World Cup in? It's because it specifically opens and it says like December, what was it, 2025 or
2022.
Yeah. So I was like, has the World Cup been so disrupted that it's, why is it happening in December? I was confused. Then I was like, maybe is it the American Cup?
No, I think they said it was the World Cup, and I don't know enough. Maybe I'm just naive. I don't know enough Americans that would have a party to watch it.
Yeah.
And I was like, it wasn't even an American team that was playing. So
yeah.
I think it was Brazilian or something.
Yeah, it was Brazil.
Yeah. And when he says this one thing to his daughter, like, to be the best, you have to do something that nobody else is willing to do. And they said it like a couple of times.
Yeah. Yes.
And I'm like, all right, I can't wait to see what this turns into. Nothing. It doesn't turn into anything.
No. It does. At the end, when like she's telling him that you have to pretty much let me go and then save your future, but
But he didn't. He jumped in after her. But he didn't let her go.
He tried, but essentially she knew what was gonna happen anyway.
He didn't try at all. He just he saw her go, he jumped in right after her.
So he didn't learn the lesson there. Yeah.
Well, it just doesn't pay off. I think that's an interesting theme. You gotta do something nobody else is willing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think that's an interesting idea, especially in this context. Yeah. But then to have him not do anything, he's doing pretty much kind of what other people would do.
Right. Yeah. I thought it would be like Armageddon when he stayed behind and then.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Which is often a theme in this kind of save the world scenario, mm-hmm. right? That there ultimately is some level of self-sacrifice for the greater good, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In this one, you get the potential there for the self-sacrifice of a parent in terms of not being able to save their child. But yeah, you're right, because from a character decision, an active character perspective, he doesn't actually seem to make the choice to let her go. He dives in after, and we get that nice, really mm-hmm. Renaissance-esque mm-hmm. painting. Yeah.
Great, great cinematography. Great scene. Yeah.
That's probably my favorite for sure. It reminded me again of, what was it? Maybe Thor 2, the Valkyrie. Mm-hmm. When she was remembering her past and the war that led to the demise.
Oh, yeah. Ragnarok. That was the third one.
Ragnarok.
Yes.
So that was a good shot. Also, this theme of not sacrificing anything. When his dad, spoiler alert, he's no, I'm going to save you.
Right. I mean, I will appreciate that because that did feel that felt like the classic cliche, I mean, it was already kind of cliche anyway, because it was main character with daddy issues. It's yes, we've seen that a million times. Mm-hmm. And so then it's it does feel oh, this is how we're going to resolve daddy issues, is daddy's going to self-sacrifice here, and instead it's no, he manages to save his dad, and then now it's I guess, hey,
he's the,
you guys can
guy.
Actually reconcile, you don't get the easy way out.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
But it is kind of funny that it's oh yeah, nope. Foiled.
Yeah. And it is important to note, it's a super jacked J.K. Simmons.
Seriously. He is jacked in this.
Yeah.
What was he doing?
I don't know. I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, overall, I like that. I like I liked where the daughter went, where she became a scientist and she's a colonel in the military. So she achieved mm-hmm. some success in both worlds. Mm-hmm. Although I guess I'm wondering, I don't remember exactly the timeline of when the attack started, because she had time to go to MIT to pursue a PhD and time to spend in the military in service.
Yeah.
Well, they do say 30 years in the future. That's when the war is currently happening.
Hmm.
And so the assumption is, how old is she? When, I don't know.
No idea.
He has all that time. She grows up. And all of that. So yeah, I think there's plenty of time for her to be able to have gone to MIT and had some experience and still be alive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But now, am I wrong? Am I remembering this correctly? But she's also responsible for the technology that makes time travel possible.
You know, I don't think so. I don't remember her being responsible for that.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Because the time travel aspect of the story to me feels like the weakest of all of the sci-fi aspects. Like, spoiler alert, I do appreciate that they kind of, like, there were definitely things, like, as I went along, and I would have a question. And this is one thing I definitely can say I appreciate about the movie. I was like, I would have a question of, like, oh, why? That's interesting. Why can only some people go, not others? And then it's like, oh yeah, because you got to be dead. They're trying to avoid paradox and all that kind of stuff. And then like, why is it so tied to a specific time? Oh, it's like they've managed to open a wormhole, and it like they're kind of, the tunnel's moving through time at the same pace on either end, and therefore you can jump.
Like a river, Michael.
It's like a river, which is a classic description of time. So it's like they did a decent job of like, oh, okay, they're answering these questions as they feel like they should naturally be coming up. But on the whole, the time travel aspect did still just kind of feel hand-wavy, like, hey, we figured out time travel. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, that's fascinating. You figure out time travel in this capacity. And then, but it's like limited in these specific ways, and we don't get a sense of like, yeah, but we might be able to figure out how to do it in other ways or do more with it. It works conveniently for the story, but it feels very much like a MacGuffin in that way, where it's just like, it's useful to move the plot forward.
But I would argue I think they answered that. They weren't meant to do it this way. Like, they were really trying to go slow, and then this attack happened. They're like, well, we got to hurry up and figure out something to do with this, because otherwise we're all just going to die. Mm-hmm. Like, I think they would have eventually like tried to figure out other ways to kind of work on it and create the process. But
right. It
was like, we just developed this. We don't have time to really think it through, because we just have to suddenly find people to fight this war. How much explanation do you need?
I mean for me, as a guy who loves sci-fi and wrote a time travel novel, all the explanation in the world.
what a brag.
I need it all.
I know,
because I just want to know more.
Wait, can we plug our own personal work here?
Absolutely. That's what this is actually all about. It's entirely just a shameless ploy to do that.
Speaking of time travel, one question I had is, what happens to the people who came and were training, the civilians, once that link was lost? So the girl or the lady or soldier who, spoiler alert, goes on that snow trip, what happens to them, people like them? Because if technically they are so young that they haven't been born yet,
Well, yeah, and what if their parents were sent forward and they died in the war, so now they can't be born? What happens then?
Yeah, and then you also have to, well, it depends on like if you're going to take sort of a Back to the Future view of time, right, where this is all happening in a singular timeline, and so that would potentially erase them, or I felt like the movie kind of hinted at this, at more of the multiverse view here, where in reality, not every world is getting saved. And you know, when he's jumping forward in time to go fight this, he's really getting the answer to come back and actually prevent it from happening. It's not that it's never going to happen in that world, because then you create this paradox, this contradiction, but that now is creating a new timeline where it doesn't happen.
Right, so because his daughter doesn't remember that, or she has, it's not part of her memories that he was gone for this time fighting this war.
That's not the story she tells of him. You know, yeah. And so if it's the multiverse theory, that kind of means maybe those people who are stuck there, they just are stuck there. And whether or not in this particular multiverse, their parents actually are alive anymore or not, doesn't affect the fact that the multiverse they came from, their parents were alive and did conceive them. So one way to, I guess, explain it. But though the specific examples you cited, they don't get to stick around and figure that out.
Nope. Spoilers.
Spoilers.
Yeah.
And I, you know, the other thing I will say that I did appreciate that, you know, again, a question that came up to me in the movie was, man, why is it that so often we've got these, like, you know, very monstery like aliens that show up and all they want to do is kill us, you know, but somehow they're intelligent enough to get here. You know, I'm thinking this, and then of course we do get a what I would say is essentially a Prometheus type answer to this. And I was like, okay, well, at least you guys were thinking about this too. That it's like, it, you know, because it's fun to make a essentially what is a action monster movie. But if the you know, if the monsters are aliens that somehow got here, and that involves high intelligence and technology, then it doesn't make sense for them to be these monsters that are running around biting people in half. It makes more sense for them to be more the Independence Day monsters that are just, you know, blowing buildings up and taking over the world with technology, you know, because they have just much higher technology than us. My thoughts, at least.
Yeah, I did appreciate that. It was, they're not aliens per se, they're really just an organic creature that was already here, and they just happen to be super aggressive and destructive.
Yeah.
A question I had about, like, this, I mean, well, unless like I missed it or something, but if there's one scene, spoiler, where he says they're coming for her, and I did not get the sense throughout, like, prior to that scene, that they set it up that it was like there's like a link or connection that, oh, if one of us is in danger or one of us needs something, then let's go save, I don't know, like the queen bee or something. Like, did I miss something?
There was a little line. It was quick, but there was, like, because when they first showed him footage of, like, that, you know, like the infrared footage or whatever of the queen.
Yeah.
They did mention it was, like, it was real quick though, but I do remember there was a mention of, like, the fact that the drones basically seem to respond to her, and if she is in distress, they'll come from wherever and just fight to the death to defend her. So there was a little hint of that. It was interesting because it was like, oh, but no, like, can they swim or not? But apparently they can. Yeah. So your middle of the ocean base is, whoops. And, you know.
I found that that's like an oversight of this movie, is that they know that the queen can summon everybody else or send out a signal.
Right.
And they know that this one's like a pretty big and bad one. Like, we have to capture this one for sure. And then, like, they know she's secreting some kind of sweat or pheromones. And they don't take any precautions. They're like, whatever, we'll figure it out.
I mean, they did sedate her. So they're like, every hour, we are controlling her so that she wouldn't be agitated enough to, you know, make the others think that she's in distress. I'm guessing that's the rationale they were going with.
I feel like there should be much more security all the time, 24/7, looking at her, making sure nothing's happening.
It's a war. It's a war. They don't have the resources to be able to, you know, give to every bit, you know? It's like the scarce, like, resources. Yeah, that's why they went back to get more people, right? So
Yeah.
What did they get down to? Like 500,000. Yeah. Because for a moment later, I was like reflecting on it and I was like, so what are the chances that, you know, his daughter would like both be like this, like, you know, rise in rank to such a place, you know, and but also be like this scientist that's like doing stuff. You know, and then I was like, 500,000 people sounds like a lot of people, but when you stop and actually, I think it's just we have a hard time wrapping our heads around like numbers, but when you think about there are actually like something like 7 billion people on the planet, and which is an even more unfathomable number, but when you really think about it, like 500,000 people, that is like nothing. So she's one of the few left. It's like, actually, statistically speaking, it's about a pretty decent chance of it.
Yeah.
All things considered, I'll give them that one.
Yeah. Would my question, I guess, is I guess I see why all the world governments would band together, like, oh, we got to help this prevent this problem. But seeing all the heavy losses and like we're essentially losing no matter what. How long do you think we would continue to stay in that effort?
I mean,
not long.
What's the alternative? You know, because I mean we're talking about the extinction of the species, so yeah.
I'm sorry to cut you off.
Oh no, go ahead.
I'm just really cynical, so. I feel like I don't have hope of even look at this pandemic. It's like when you think about, you know, vaccine redistribution or even sending the raw ingredients to countries for them to be able to make it. Like there's so many countries that are still like struggling and still rising cases. I mean, I don't see how when I feel like it would be each country for themselves. Especially when it comes to like threat of extinction. I don't foresee people holding out. I mean, the leaders of the nation holding out long term.
Well, I think so. You bring up a good point, Nah, because one thing I've thought about during this pandemic is the reason why most people don't take it seriously enough is because it's not like a heavy casualty kind of pandemic. But if like 1 in 3 people died from COVID-19, I think people would take it a lot more seriously. And so I think in that aspect, I think Michael, in other episodes that I've heard, you talk about how a lot of sci-fi in the future is like really cynical and really like everybody for themselves. So I think it's interesting they presented this world as, hey, we're all going to band together. We're going to just throw unlimited resources at this forever, no matter what.
Yeah, it does present a bit of a different perspective. It is in that sense optimistic, that an optimistic outlook on the human race, you know, which is, I think, noteworthy in its own way. Again, it's like it's working. Part of it, I think, is the type of genre. You know, like this is like an Independence Day. It's a hoorah! Humanity will rise up, and we will defeat, you know, the aliens. But there is an element I think is worth celebrating and appreciating, at least, about that type of storytelling, which is to say that actually maybe there are some ways in which, in that kind of a situation, we can appeal to the better angels of our nature, you know, to borrow the phrase, and actually work selflessly towards a bigger goal, a bigger resolution. And I often find myself wondering, like, how would those kinds of things play out in reality? movies and novels get to compress reality to a degree, mm-hmm. and kind of put human nature inside of a pressure cooker, mm-hmm. and kind of be like, yeah. hey, like, what under these extreme circumstances, what's going to happen? I think it's cool that way. I think there is also, like you said, a distinction to be made towards reality. So yeah, we're you know, still contending with a global pandemic, and I even just have seen and heard from people who, you know, it didn't come home for them. It didn't set in for them, the reality and the impact of it, until it became personal. Right. And, and I think that continues to be an issue in so many things, whether we're talking about a pandemic, whether we're talking about race, or any of the other major problems, even just infrastructure in our country, right? It's the quote unquote not sexy topic to talk about, and yet it has such a massive impact on our lives. And so that even still today, there are people in Flint, Michigan, who can't drink their water, right? Because of lead pipes. And it's not a sexy thing to talk about. And it's like localized. So it's a huge issue for the people in a specific community, but it's like, it's not a huge issue for the rest of us. I can turn my faucet on and go on with my life. And finding the ways to personalize it are the challenge, and finding the ways to deal with the slower moving problems that we have in reality becomes its own challenge to address. And it's something I like to see more science fiction deal with. I think more novels have a easier time of doing that. So I just had Octavia Cade on the show, and she wrote the Stone Weta novel that deals with scientists having to protect data around climate change, because it's not being disseminated, it's being changed, tweaked, cool. you know, it is an example of a much more slow moving problem in a lot of ways. But what she does so well in the novel is bring together the human impact and the tough choices that all the characters are women scientists, and each of these women has to make really tough choices and ask themselves, how far is too far? What am I willing to do to protect this for the greater good? What is the personal cost to me? I want to keep my job. I want to stay alive. My family, you know, all these other sort of considerations. It's tougher to do in a movie. And certainly the action movies like this are not kind of like designed for that.
Yeah.
On the flip side, I don't know. I'd love to hear what you guys think, because I think, you know, I kind of wonder sometimes too, if on the flip side, we kind of need that like hoorah injection from an action movie like this to kind of like remind us that, hey, maybe we could be capable of like putting our minds into it and like jumping in with both feet and actually rising to the challenge.
I don't know.
You don't know?
I just remember that like the one scene prior to their trip to Russia, the guy was like, hey, I'm swamped. People are whatever.
Yeah.
Imagine. Yeah. I feel like there's so many, even now, like for different issues, you know, like, well, my priority lies somewhere else and I have to deal with all these different things. So what you're talking about, sure, it's an issue, but I mean, I can't wait. It's not like life or death or whatever. I don't So my answer would be no.
We can't band together, you don't think?
Can't band together.
Am I too cynical? Maybe I am. Maybe like, you know, they say the kids are, you know, the generation, the future, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe younger people are more, what's the word?
Idealistic.
Idealistic, perhaps, and more willing to give of themselves than others would be. Because sometimes I look at things going on right now and I don't understand it, but it's different mindsets and everything. So I don't know, maybe, who knows? So maybe it will be good to represent this in movies and stuff like that. So, because, you know, representation matters.
That absolutely.
People are working together to actually do something.
Yes. Yes. I mean, I think about Independence Day. Right. That's like the ultimate motivation. Like, let's all work together. Let's work and let's figure out this problem out. I don't know. I feel like there's space for both. You got to have, I do think you got to have, because if they're in the absence of nobody, like, I agree. No, it's easy to be cynical because our track record as a world is not great. So that means there's no model, right? There's no model of how we can do it. So movies and perhaps even novels, but movies are just easier to, because not everybody reads.
They're far more widely consumed for sure. So I think there's a special weight on movies to address this in TV shows. Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a good way of modeling what it could look like. Mm-hmm. Right. I think that's something I do in training. When you train somebody on how to do something, especially if they're new to it, they've never done it before, you have to actually show them what it looks like or how it could look like. Mm-hmm. So I think movies could play that role of, this is how you work together. This is how it all works. And to Michael's point, that means every movie now has to have like a 30-minute diversion where they go into like a conference talk about like like the really nitty gritty science. Like, I want to see the p-values. I want to see all the data. I want to see like everything. And this is how it's going to work. Like, just really sprinkle in deep, detailed science into like every movie from now on.
That's I don't know if you can do it in every movie. I mean, you know, I love the science and I love the geek out on things. I think at the end of the day, you know, I pick on it a little bit for the hand-wavy nature of the time travel, but to be fair, it's really kind of not a time travel movie. Like, that's like, in its true sense, it's not trying to really focus on that so much, because to the point where, like, even it's kind of like not even really interested in dealing with the potential paradoxes that are just born out of the whole scenario of time travel. So it's like pick on it a little bit. I think there is a sense in which ultimately a story has to be a good story first, right? And then you can do all those other fun things with it and those other important things with it, but it does actually have to like hook us in and then keep us glued and interested. And as I've addressed it in the past, when in sort of talking about the pessimistic aspects of science fiction, I think there's often, it's an easier road to travel to a degree because it's riddled with conflict, you know? So you have like ready-made stories, an easy path to go when you make a dystopian future, or, you know, you just kind of make all characters selfish and all that kind of stuff. Because it's like, oh yeah, that's an easy route to go at. And then it plays out in a sort of somewhat predictable way. But I do think, to your point about our track record as a species isn't great. Interestingly enough, I believe it's Steven Pinker who from Harvard, who wrote a book called Enlightenment Now, and he kind of argues against that point. He actually says, you know, he's kind of takes major issue essentially with what he kind of labels liberal pessimism. There's this like inherent tendency within more liberal political realms to always be sounding the alarm and always be like, we're doomed, and like it, we gotta like rally the troops right this second, because this is it. Like we're just terrible human beings and we gotta like completely change ourselves. And he is arguing more toward the end of, actually, if we try to contextualize and examine history, first appreciate that our brains naturally focus on negative information. It's a survival thing.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So
sure.
That's all the negative examples stand out to us. But then looking at what we've accomplished, even just in the last couple of centuries as a species, he would concur with Obama's statement that he had made, I think, at a commencement speech that people started picking on, about this being the best time to be alive. And Pinker says, well, yeah, statistically speaking, if you look back at the history of the human race and what your chances were of survival and of even having a decent life, being born in the world today, you are at least statistically far more likely to end up having a better shot at life than most humans have in human history. And it's, you know, so it's an interesting read. All of that to say, I think there is, again, an aspect in which both movies and our brains are wired to latch on to the negative information. And just storytelling in general in that sense. And then it becomes the challenge of how do we use the negative as a launching point and then potentially shine light on, but here's the possibilities of where we manage to rise above it, you know. And I think there's examples out there, but that continues to be, I think, challenging to do that. Sorry, geeked off there for quite a bit.
No.
Well, I mean, I think when I hear that, I agree that statistically we have a much better chance of survival and like things are really much better. Like, but the problem with that is it's taking statistics and averaging over like the entire world, right? So like,
right.
So it doesn't account for like the really extremes at the bottom of the scale.
For sure. For sure.
Or like where you are in the world, like though that's still going to make a difference.
For sure. Yeah.
I will say when he first meets his adult daughter and he's like trying to reconcile with her, I don't even know why he's reconciling. He's just like, there's nothing to reconcile yet. Mm-hmm. It did make me tear up a little bit.
Oh.
Like I feel like I felt like the emotion of like, he's like happy to see her and like that hesitation and like that joy. And like, he just went through a lot. So I felt it, made me tear up.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I did not feel a thing. My automatic
apparently is dead inside.
I have really my best instinct was, oh no, I hope this is not like a love interest, even though he has a wife back home.
Yeah. A wife and a kid, yeah.
Yeah. And
nope, it's not. Don't worry.
Yeah. And then I was like, oh, daughter, cool.
Yeah. What did you think of his line towards the beginning of the movie where he was like, I was meant for something special?
Right. I feel like I thought that was interesting because basically the daughter alluded to that same thing, that was the reason why he basically left the family, because he wasn't happy.
Yeah.
Guess what he was trying to do in the beginning didn't pan out. And I guess even after coming back, he never really did anything more with his life. And he felt like teaching high school, I don't know, chemistry or biology wasn't worth it.
Yeah.
That he was meant for something greater.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought it was interesting. You did, I mean, because he has his past as a Marine. Mm-hmm. And you'd think that's
some,
yeah.
Pretty pretty great things there potentially, but yeah.
Yeah.
That was interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's so odd that he wants to get into whatever lab, biotech or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's not easy to become a teacher. Like right. There's lots of qualifications you have to do. Like, and you could easily just, I feel like you'd easily get a job at any biotech company, even at a low level position, and move your way up
mm-hmm.
over time. So I find it weird that he can't get into this. He can't break into this industry.
They did say they need industry experience or something.
Yeah. But,
so.
Yeah, I guess.
So yeah, like it almost seemed like, yeah, like you said, maybe was he just like trying to jump the line a little too much, like trying to get too high of a position. Mm-hmm. Like maybe he should have just been getting lower. But yeah, I asked because it's like, oh, it was an interesting moment. It was like one of the few moments that like I dinged the movie pretty hard for that one. I was like, ooh, it's a weird line. And I get what you guys are trying to do, but honestly, he kind of sounds like an asshole right now. Like, give me a break. Like, yeah. I don't know. It's just, and maybe it's my own baggage, but it's just like, really, I don't really want to, you know, see Mr. Good looking white guy feel like
I was meant for something greater.
And I'm just like, geez, yeah, we have a whole generation of those, man. Like, come on.
Michael, you don't feel like you're meant for something special?
See, I think that's my problem, and maybe why I was so turned off by that moment, because like me at like 25 or maybe like between 25 and 30, I think totally believe that. Me at 40, hogwash. You know, like, no, it's just not how life works. I wasn't meant for nothing. What I am meant to do is to do what every single other person on this planet has to do, which is wake up and face the day. And
well, that's why you won't save the world from it. That's why you're not gonna save the world. That's why Naa is going to be a famous star, is because she's.
I was meant for something greater. So I'm going to quit my job and then go, I don't know, waitress, and then land the dream role. I have a question for you guys. Kind of tied in, well, not really tied into what you asked, but can someone refresh my memory between when the future people came and when he was drafted? How long was that?
It was like a year.
Okay.
So my question then is, were the students, or maybe one student, their cynicism warranted? It's like, what does it matter? School, like, great, whatever, life. I'm like, chill. You're just a kid.
Right. They got cynical fast.
Yeah. I feel like lots of kids already feel like that now. And then to know that, hey, in like a couple of decades, these aliens are going to come over, take over the world. They're going to kill everybody. And whoever we send is not really going to help. We're still losing the war. So nothing matters.
Yeah.
Not the volcano guy, though. He's still pretty optimistic.
I don't know if he was optimistic. He was just passionate about volcanoes.
I mean, passionate.
That's probably another scene that like, it was fun, but I dinged the movie pretty hard on, because I'm just like,
which one?
The fact that it's like, oh, we found this ash on, you know,
who do you know?
So who do you know? Like, literally, like, so aren't you scientists? And you have like all this stuff at your disposal, and you have to go to your high schooler.
So wait, you don't buy the idea of a high school student being the foremost world expert on ancient volcano ash?
I mean, we're talking about I buy the idea that he's like could potentially know it. I don't buy the idea that in this scenario that with all the resources that are clearly available to them, that's who they would turn to. that would be his first thought. Wait, I teach this kid. who totally geeks out about volcanoes. Let's go talk to him. And you know how they're like, we know like 50 scientists you could probably talk to.
Now, Michael.
I was going to say, what I find harder to believe is that within that short period he was gone and he came back, that kid is now like the, like he can say laptop. And then, oh, he has people bring him a laptop. He's like the guru. And you're like, ooh, everybody's listening in. And nobody wanted to listen to him in the beginning. So like, oh, now he's like a cool kid.
Yeah.
This stuff. I don't know.
But why wouldn't you go to him? You gotta be able, you gotta be willing to do something nobody else will do.
It's what it is.
So nobody else will go to a high school student. So you, this is clearly what you have to do to be great.
is that a potential how it should have ended video right there where it's like they go and they can't find the thing and they're just like, ah, guess we shouldn't have consulted a high school student.
That would be so funny. But now that you mentioned it, like when in the earlier conversation about, you know, the world banding together, they kind of said the opposite when they were like, oh, let's tell everybody and it will take the UN or whatever, NATO or something, years to just keep talking about it and do nothing. Right. So they kind of alluded to the fact that, you know, when there's so many hands involved, it's like it's gonna become like
yeah it's odd because she was working on something that everybody knows she's working on. It's clearly enough that they give her resources to capture this queen, and then when she produces it, nobody seems to care
because the borders are being overrun and then this people and then that people, so they don't have time.
There's never any time.
Yeah, I think that just goes back to your comment of they didn't seem to think this through, right? Which is a bit unbelievable that it, like, it, I, maybe that's just, it makes for compelling storytelling in terms of like it's good for the structure of the story and the conflict. But I think in that scenario, it's a little like, really though, they wouldn't have been working round the clock on thinking about all the possible scenarios and all the possible responses. That's how tactical military works. You know, mm-hmm. like you're going to mm-hmm. think through all these various scenarios, and they're going to be thinking about the fact that, you know, she's going to produce these pheromones that these things are going to be wanting to come after. We got to either figure out how to seal and contain that, or we got to be ready for some kind of response. And they don't seem prepared for that at all.
There's only so much 500,000 people can do, Michael.
This is true. This is a fair
so
point.
Much.
Only. So
yeah.
Much.
Yeah. When they're at the ice, at the snow at the end, and they get off their plane and they start using their snowmobiles to scan, wouldn't it be a little easier to just fly the plane over and scan a larger area faster?
Probably. I mean, it seems like there's probably all, I mean, you know, you get into this interesting territory where, you know, like you want to, like, it makes sense to degree like that not all technology leaps forward at the same pace. And yet you always get that. It's tough as an audience member, I think, sometimes to be like, wait, you figured out time travel, but you can't see through ice. Which one sounds harder? Like, you know, like some, there's some suspension of disbelief, I guess.
Today. Michael, have you heard of the, what's it called? Idiom, is it? I think necessity is the mother of invention.
Yes.
They did not need to see through ice. They needed. Fair.
That's true. That's true.
Figure out time travel, right?
So, until that moment, right? It was not a felt need. All right, fair enough. Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Yep. Nah wins.
Nah wins. I like it.
Nah wins the debate. Another interesting observation that the first third of the movie that ended with like the bombing and like they're running through the tunnel and like, or they're running through the streets and they have to save this two people that fell, and then they're running. Like it built, like the music built up so much, and it was like, this is like the end scene of like any other action movie. And I was like, oh wait, there's like an hour and a half left of this movie. What's going on with this? What's happening?
Right. I mean, yeah, there really was like, yeah, there's a sense in which they you're right. They packed in like a couple movies at least into this, like structurally. It's like, an interesting way to do it. And the crazy part though is that got done watching the movie and I was like, okay, I'll get on like IMDb and rate it and stuff. And immediately it's like already seeing like the news articles of like Amazon already in talks for sequel to The Tomorrow War. You know, this stuff's like, what are they gonna do for part two? That's interesting. They discover another frozen alien ship that landed thousands of years ago.
Someone escaped. One of them escaped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or it's not just in Russia, elsewhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Or now it's the intelligent version of the aliens. Mm. They're going to show up and they're going to do something more smart-like.
Or is a sequel the next lead into Edge of Tomorrow?
Those
kind of aliens.
Mm-hmm. All right. You know, as I was watching this, I was thinking too, it's like this, except for the fact that the aliens are totally different looking, it almost, you could almost just blend the Tomorrow War and Quiet Place movies together, you know, because those aliens too, my theory is, if, because they're supposed to be making a third one for that. This is bonus movie discussion, by the way. my theory there is that, again, we've got these like monstrous aliens that seem hell-bent on killing people. But like, why would they come to Earth, you know? And so again, I think biological weapon, right? So you could, you know, so it almost feels like, oh, if they had looked just a little bit similar, then you could have almost had them actually be more or less in the same universe, taking place in different places. But the aliens operate in very different ways. These don't seem to rely. These have eyes. They don't rely on hearing.
Mm. I've never seen A Quiet Place 1 or 2, so I can't postulate on that. Mm-hmm. But what I would love to see is a cinematic universe of The Tomorrow War, Edge of Tomorrow, and Tomorrow Never Dies.
The Tomorrow Trilogy. I want to, yeah, how would you tie in Tomorrow Never Dies into that? I'm curious about that.
I mean, if you want chronologically, that's the first one in the series. Okay. That's like late 90s.
Mm-hmm. Just some random stuff happens, no connection in characters, and then
yep, and then the Tomorrow War, and then Edge of Tomorrow. Like, we won this war, and then, but in the future, some time traveling aliens come back.
Yeah, because they figured out time travel.
Yeah.
And they're actually the ones that gave us time travel to defeat the other aliens so that we would be around to fight with them in this other war. Hey, you know, like that's, I could get into that.
What about this movie? The sequel is some kind of Avatar blend where now humans are sympathizing with the white species and then they want to be like them.
we want to become white spike spitting. Yes,
they
weirdos.
Identify you. That's... you've heard of those people who are like, I don't identify as, you know, white anymore, or I identify as Korean.
Yep.
There's legit someone who says that. So
did they have connection to Korea?
That's a whole other story.
They just watched a lot of Korean soap opera and listened to K-pop.
No, I mean, we could get into it, but yeah.
I think that's an interesting concept. Like, if aliens, like from Aliens 3, if they decide to ally with humans, like that kind of like primal type of alien that doesn't really think high order or like communicate, and they just ally with us against another species.
Like coneheads?
Coneheads, yes.
Coneheads. I mean, they came and they were just like chilling here, so. Yeah.
Like that. Yep.
Fair. Fair point. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean.
Yeah. I love the direction this is going.
Yeah. We are.
Can you start writing that?
Yes. So we can finance it and then, you know, get it out of the door.
Yeah.
Sounds perfect. I mean, there's some slight IP questions that we'll have to figure out who we have to license the existing intellectual property from. But yeah, sure.
Completely doable.
Completely doable.
You take care of it.
I think it will expedite things if we just do it all under the protection of satire laws. So if it's just straight up satire, then we're it's fair game.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, or Tommy Wiseau has tons of money. We could always enlist him to finance it.
True. So Tommy, if you're listening to this, you know. I'm scared of where that money comes from. So guys, well, thank you so much for geeking out, laughing, having a good time talking about this movie and getting to talk about even some serious aspects of it. I hope we can do this again.
Same. Thank you for having me. I would love to do it again. I'll probably be bugging you, Michael.
Perfect. Sounds good. Perfect.
This was great. You know, Michael, if this is your highest rated episode, that means Naa has to be your co-host going forward.
There you go.
She's the X factor for this.
She's the X factor for this. Yeah. Yeah. It wasn't the fact that you had a picture of Chris Pratt behind you.
No. If this is the lowest rated one, though, let's just blame Chris and then.
Yeah, that's true. We don't blame Chris. We'll blame because we had I have other stats on Chris. We just blame the movie.
Yes, that's the
clear scapegoat will definitely be the movie.
Yeah.
So Naa, where can we can keep up with you?
You can keep up with me through food.
Through food?
Yes, you can follow me on my food blog at Faceless Foods on Instagram, where I share my journey with food all the time. So that's how you can stay up to date with me.
Awesome.
What's it called?
Faceless Foods.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm.
What kind of food do you like to review the most?
Oh, I just do whatever. I eat whatever I want, and I cook whatever I want, and then I go to. So it's a mixture of what I cook and places I go to in around Boston and where I live. So
perfect. That's cool. So especially for the Boston folks.
Yes.
There's some perks there. Discover some new eats.
Yes.
Awesome.
When I travel, I'll add that. But yeah, mostly in Boston, in and around Boston.
Sweet. Chris, anything you want to plug?
I mean, you could follow me at my Instagram at Faceless Foods.
That's yours too. Wow. Nice. That's really funny that you both have the same. I was not aware of this partnership.
No, I don't have any socials, so you can't follow me.
You can't follow. He's invisible. He's just here for the fun of it.
Yep.
For the fun.
Got no.
He's here for the aliens.
Plug. Yeah.
He just, you know, he's just a fan of the medium.
I just love movies.
That's right. Thanks, Abed.
Six seasons in a movie.
I literally just finished the sixth season today. I'd never seen it. Yeah.
Oh, I have to catch up. I haven't. I started, but I paused. So
yeah.
That'll be our next podcast episode.
Okay.
Talking community. Sci-fi references in community.
It's hilarious. So
yeah, it really is. So. That's great.
Well, yeah, thanks for having us. This is awesome.
Yeah. Excellent. Thanks for doing this, guys. All right. I hope you enjoyed our fun, geeky, friendly conversation about the Tomorrow War. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. Thank you for stopping by, checking out the podcast. If you're a regular listener, you may have noticed that it's been a couple weeks here since I've updated podcasts. I've been sort of rather busy. And to fill you in on a little bit of what's been going on, I actually have been working on pre-production for a short film that I wrote and that I did the cinematography for. So I was behind the camera and I gave the script to a talented friend of mine to star and direct in the film. And so she agreed to do that. And we just completed production this past weekend. So there's been a lot going on with work and life and all of that. And as a result, I haven't had a chance to catch up on doing some of the podcast things as often as I'd like to. But the Tomorrow War seemed like a good time to jump back in. And I really appreciate Chris and Na stopping by and being able to just have a fun conversation with some friends. Hopefully it's engaging and thoughtful, raises some fun questions for you as well. As always, I'm curious about seeing how science fiction can depict a future in which we work together to overcome some big problems. And I think there's some things to be said about that in this movie, and I look forward to seeing what they do next with this franchise, even if ultimately I think it's sort of middle-of-the-road sci-fi, tropey and fun, but not necessarily the best stuff in the world. All that to say, as far as value for your time in terms of entertainment, it certainly stacks up for that. So thank you again for listening. I do encourage you to check out other episodes of the podcast. If you're a new listener, please do check out my website, michaelwhistler.com. That's where you can learn more about my work as a science fiction writer and filmmaker and see some of the things I've done. You can actually get a free copy of my first novel if you sign up for my mailing list, which frankly I need to actually pick up really doing more with. You can also check out my blog there where I talk a lot about the different aspects of science fiction that stand out to me and things that I'm thinking about and reading about. So take a look, michaelwhistler.com, and there's also links there to where you can check out my novels and short stories. And more news about those kinds of things will be coming up soon, and exciting news to share very soon. So looking forward to that. In the meantime, if you have any questions or comments, please do reach out to me. You can do that through my website. There's a form on there for being able to contact me. If you're watching this on YouTube, go ahead and comment below. I do try to follow up on comments, so let me know what you're thinking. If you have a topic you'd like to see discussed on this podcast, I want to hear from you. What kind of questions, what kind of topics, what kind of movies and books? Are there comic books and graphic novels, other mediums where science fiction has explored some fascinating ideas that you would like me to dive into? I certainly welcome that. So thank you again for listening. Please be safe and well out there. Continue to recommend good science fiction to each other and continue, as always, to ask big questions. We'll see you later.